I would like to continue with the discussion of reservoir triggered seismicity. And I would like to give you some ideas about what to do regarding the assessment of reservoir triggered seismicity and monitoring of reservoir triggered seismicity. I mentioned already that any large dam with a height exceeding about 100 meters is a candidate for RTS. And to assess its potential, the following data are basically needed. Number one, tectonic conditions and data on structural geology, supported by study of aerial photographs. I must say, I'm not an earth scientist, I'm a civil engineer. So this is basically a task of geologists, seismotectonic experts, seismologists. Number two, we should look into macro seismic data for the reservoir, which have to be looked at. Okay, that means a catalog of seismicity. Number three, information on active faults and all data on the recent fault activity in a dam and reservoir region. Number four, assessment of seismic capability of all faults in dam and reservoir region. So there will be based on the rupture length and using some empirical relations, some upper bound magnitudes can be estimated. And also the regimes of underground water plays a role. Now the case studies which are discussed in the bulletin 137, I just want to mention here, I do not discuss them in detail, but I just want to mention that reservoir triggered seismicity has actually different features. It is not just one feature which is very clear. Number one, Xinfengjiang buttress dam in China is a representative of large triggered seismicity causing a strong local earthquake which significantly damaged the dam. So Koina Dam would also belong into this group. The second case study which is presented there is Mratinje Arch Dam in former Yugoslavia. It is a representative of moderate reservoir triggered seismicity. It is of particular interest as seismic monitoring was introduced prior on and after impounding. And there was some reappearance of RTS after 17 years of service. So it's quite an interesting case. And number three, Kuroba Arch Dam in Japan was also monitored prior and after impounding. The dam was reported as an RTS case on the basis of microseismic monitoring after impounding, but later analysis led to the conclusion that Kurobe Dam was not an RTS case. So you see, it is not so clear to say if a case actually has been RTS. Number four, Takese Rockfield Dam was in Japan, is a large dam monitored prior and after impounding. This is very essential, where similar microseismic activity was present before and after impounding. So it is not really clear if there is some effect on seismicity on RTS. And Puechos embankment dam in Peru is a case of seismically active environment where RTS was absent or was masked by basic background activity. So depending on the seismicity, we have different features. It is difficult basically to judge if it is RTS, but I would say it is essential in all cases that in order to, let me say, minimize possible claims if some seismicity appears, is to do a seismic monitoring prior to dam construction and then to monitor activity during reservoir impounding and during the first year of operation. Now, this is one case, is the second largest arch dam in Africa. It is a Katse arch dam, and there it is in a basaltic rock area just after the after the impounding of the reservoir. You see here a 1.5 kilometer long fissure appeared. Okay, you see here it opened about 5 to 10 centimeters, and it destroyed also some well. So the owner, basically, he paid for it. But it is possible that due to stress redistribution in highly stressed region, such features are possible. Now, there are other cases which are blamed as being caused by RTS. I mentioned already a couple of times going on gravity dam. Okay. And number two, seeping two concrete face rock fill dam, which I have discussed. So here, there are some people suspecting reservoir triggered seismicity. Also, from the engineering point of view, there is no clear evidence if that has been the case. Now, what has to be done when RTS is expected in a new dam project? As I mentioned at the beginning, RTS and the magnitude of the largest RTS events cannot be predicted at the given site. And since the dam owner will have to pay for any related damages, I would say we have to recommend the following. First, in such situations, and it relates also to large dams, I must say, with 8 larger than 100 meters and large reservoirs. So number one is to install a microseismic monitoring system recording seismicity during all project phases. That means before and before construction of a dam and during impounding and during operation of a reservoir. Number two, if increased seismicity is observed during impounding, then filling of a reservoir may be interrupted. This would have to be discussed with responsible people. Okay, so one would see if that would become an issue. Number three, it is necessary or it is recommended to prepare a photographic inventory of all buildings and infrastructure projects in the dam and reservoir region in order to prevent false claims. It is typical if you do not do such inventory and if some seismicity is observed, then people will come up with hundreds or even thousands of claims, and they will see some cracks here and there, but the origin of these cracks may be different than this observed earthquake. So it is quite a cumbersome work, but I would say if you want to protect yourself as an owner, I would say it is the only thing you can do, actually, to minimize your possible liability. Number four, it could be feasible to improve the resistance of seismically weak buildings, or even to purchase them, okay, if that is necessary. And number five, okay, you can still buy insurance coverage for property damage. So there are a number of, things which you could do in order to protect yourself if you are a dam owner from possible effects of reservoir triggered seismicity. I think this represents more or less the state of the art in that field. So this is highly recommended, and we have done this kind of things in the case of a project here in Colombia. That the situation is not so simple is shown here. People suspected reservoir trigger seismicity in a dam which is called Sogamoso, concrete face rock fill dam, about 190 meters high. And in the reservoir area, there were already before dam construction, there were already landslides. You see here, this is a bridge, and it was displaced about 50 meters here during a landslide. And of course, if during impounding of a reservoir, we may have some small earthquakes, it may reactivate this landslide. I'm not sure how people remained or who would finally be responsible for any damage if it would occur during the pounding of the reservoir. Now, to give a brief summary of on RTS, probability of RTS increases with the dam height and reservoir size. RTS potential needs to be considered, I would say, for dams with a height of more than 100 meters and of and also for large reservoirs. Number two, triggered earthquakes are seismic events which needed effects of reservoir load and pore pressure buildup to be manifested. We have shown already the shear strength at fault will decrease if the pore pressure in a fault plane is increased. Number three, the magnitude and maximum surface intensity of seismic events cannot be increased through effects of reservoir impounding. So basically, if you have reservoir triggered seismicity, this earthquake would occur anyway later or sooner. So you do not input energy in the earth which would create earthquakes. Now, number four, earthquake safety of a dam is provided by checking and designing the dam against safety evaluation earthquakes, because this is larger than any reservoir trigger seismic event. So for the dam design, reservoir trigger seismic seismicity does not have to be considered as a separate load case. Number six, earthquake safety of appurtenant structures and buildings in dam vicinity should be checked for RTS. Okay, if this RTS can be defined, and I must say it is relevant if RTS ground motion is estimated to be larger than the ground motion given for the designed earthquake for building codes, for example. But it is very difficult, I must say, to make estimates of the ground motion of RTS. It is not the task of civil engineers. This would be a task for seismotectonic people. And the next point is, in cases of low historical seismicity, the neotectonic studies undertaken to assess the RTS potential might lead to determination of controlling earthquake. And just to sum up, as I mentioned, there is no need to treat RTS separately as ground motion due to safety evaluation earthquake is larger than that of RTS. Number two, maximum observed magnitude of RTS is about 6.3. There have been about three of such events. It is, number three, it is impossible to prove that strong earthquakes in the order of magnitude 6.3, that this event is caused by a reservoir, as the focal depth, you know, of such earthquakes is several kilometers. In I think in Koina Dam it was not very deep, it was less than 10 kilometers, but in Siping Bu Dam it was 17 kilometers. it is impossible to know the stress state and the strength condition in fault at this depth. So therefore, there is no really evidence to prove that such earthquakes have been triggered by filling of a reservoir. However, number four, RTS may cause mass movements into a reservoir, and it may cause already large mass movements. And I've shown a number of examples, and just the example before. And if we have these mass movements, they may create impulse waves in the reservoir, and large impulse waves may lead to overtopping of a dam crest or may block intakes. And it is critical if it would block intakes of spillways and low-level outlets, which are safety critical elements. And number five, RTS may cause rockfalls, damaging appurtenant structures, and hydromechanical and electromechanical equipment. I have shown some damage from strong earthquakes, but these rockfalls occurring already under smaller earthquakes can, of course, damage cranes, for example, at intake structures and equipment on the dam crest. Number six, seismic safety of dams where large RTS events have taken place. Basically, they should be reassessed. I think that is quite normal. Number seven, when increased seismicity is observed during filling or operation of a reservoir, it must be studied how RTS could be reduced, for example, by lowering the reservoir or by reducing the annual fluctuations of the water level. Number nine, buildings and structures in the reservoir region are designed for smaller seismic forces than those of the safety evaluation earthquake. Therefore, RTS may cause damage and loss of lives in this region. And this case is in Koinanagar has been the case, because in remote places, buildings which are there, farm buildings and so on, non-engineered buildings, they have not been designed against earthquakes. So they are seismically very weak and they are therefore seismically vulnerable. So the worst effect from RTS we expect in existing buildings in the reservoir region. Also, one should keep in mind that small reservoir triggered events, which can be felt or heard, create safety concerns among the population. So if somebody hears some noise, the next days it comes in the media, and then politicians are put under pressure to take actions and so on and so on. So therefore, it is really important to make a monitoring of that. And the last point is the monitoring of the seismic activity, I would say, is a key issue. And it is important, I must say, I have to point it out, that the monitoring is done prior to construction, during impounding of a reservoir, and during the first years of reservoir operation. So this we strongly recommend. And we recommend that particularly for large storage dams. In cases where active faults pass through reservoirs and when reservoirs are located in highly tectonically stressed regions. So in these cases, I would say you should use this seismic monitoring. The seismic monitoring is usually done by means of geophones. So I would like to come here right away to the next presentation here, number two, where similar to reservoir triggered seismicity, I would like to say a few words, let me say, for the next 1.5 hours, I would like to talk about seismically active faults and discontinuities in dam foundations and reservoirs. Okay, this is basically also related directly to reservoir triggered seismicity, because if you have seismically active faults and discontinuities in dam foundations, by impounding the reservoir, this could trigger earthquakes. Okay, this here is a kind of India or greater region here in the Indian subcontinent and Himalayas, which are given some major, what shall I say, tectonic faults. And we see here, of course, in the collision zone of the Indian subcontinent with the Asian Eurasian plate, where the Himalaya is formed, you have some of a very large faults. Okay, so I would say in India, I would say you have a problem of dams on faults, I would say is a problem of the Himalayas and the foothills of the Himalayas, where still some displacements are going on and strong earthquakes are released periodically. So I would say in your case, the main concern is in this Himalayan Hindu Kush Karakoram region. Now let me say a few words about faults. This is the most famous fault. It is the San Andreas Fault in California, and it shows this fault, this plate here. This is a fault line here. It is moving in this direction, this in this direction, and we see here this river valley, for example. It is offset by several hundred meters already over a long period of time. So earthquakes have occurred along this fault zone for a long time. And you see, okay, from this aerial view, that the width of this fault is quite well defined. In other places, it is not so easy. Okay, we see here, besides the horizontal, the previous one we would call strike slip, the predominantly horizontal movement, we can have these normal faults, reverse faults, which have mainly a component in the vertical direction, as we can see here, and movements of 2, 3 meters, 4 meters are possible. On the earth surface, the fault may manifest in this way, as in the case of the Turkey earthquake in 1999. And we see here also a fault, just to see what happens if a fault passes through some building. There's a road here, and from a fault, we had an offset. It was about 5.2 meters, and the fault right went through this building here. Okay, we see here a cross section of a building. And of course, if the fault goes through a building, you can basically not design a structure, a hard structure to resist such kind of movements. Okay, and we have dams which are on such kind of faults, and I will discuss that here in the next 1.5 hours. Usually to find out if some faults are exist and what is, for example, the slip rate or what is the upper bound magnitude, people are doing some trenching. This is, I would call it a paleoseismic investigation, which is possible. Let me say, if we have some sediments, we can locate this fault, and we can date these faults also with standard methods. I've been involved in Iran where you do not have soil cover, where you have only rock, and if you have some fault plain, I must say it would become very, very difficult to do a dating of that fault if there is no debris to be found within the fault plain. Okay, so this trenching has been done in connection with the new Panama Canal, which has been completed about 4 years ago. It was a very big project. Until the old Panama Canal, you may know, is 100 years old. And when it was built, people thought Panama is a country free of earthquakes. So therefore, earthquakes in Panama were not considered. In connection with the new Panama Canal, people have done various seismotectonic studies, including such kind of trenching, and they found out that there are a number of faults which can produce quite large earthquakes. So within, let me say, the last 20 years or 15 years, Panama has become a country of almost zero seismicity to a country of high seismicity, because for the Panama Canal, if you do a dam design, suddenly the peak ground acceleration has increased basically from 0% G to almost 90% G. So it's a tremendous increase, and some politicians, of course, refuse that to accept this kind of new knowledge. So there is still some new information to be found. I would also like to show this picture about surface rupture from some earthquakes, and you have black, you have the main fault, but besides the main fault, you also have some secondary rupture close to the main fault. And if you have a dam, which is, for example, here not directed on the main fault, you can still be experience, let me say, fracture of at some discontinuities or secondary faults, which may have a negative effect on your project, which is mainly a problem. I will show that for concrete dams. Okay, you see here another dam from the US, Ridgecrest earthquake 2019. There is this main fault here, but there are then some surface fracture also appearing near the main fault. So it is not just the fault line which is very critical, because it is possible here that you have some secondary faults or ruptures. However, if the movement here in the main fault is 100%, this may be only a few percent, but for some concrete dams, this may still be critical. These are other examples of surface rupture that the fault may create various segments of ruptures, as we can see here with secondary fault. So it is quite important if we talk about dams and faults. It is not just a well-defined line, but it can bifurcate, as shown here, and it may affect the deformations in the vicinity of this main fault. Okay, basically we could understand this. Here is some example, I must say, towards the surface, the faults may split up in several subfaults, which is shown just before. It is clear at greater depth, if we look in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 kilometers, maybe the fault may really be a narrow fault line, but towards the surface, the fault may split up in different blocks, as we can see in these two examples, how it could develop in the case of a thrust fault. The previous faults which I've shown were more only horizontal displacement. I was in Myanmar, okay, also just recently, and there is the world's largest brick structure, and it was basically the pedestal of a pagoda. It should have been the largest pagoda in the world, and there was a strong earthquake in about 1900, and you can see it created a crack. It is basically here. It created several cracks here. This earthquake, but we can see it very nicely. This crack here, for example, of course, due to ground shaking, but also due to some small ground movement. This is a detail. This crack approaching the surface, it bifurcates in several smaller cracks. And that is what I try to explain here. So therefore, our dams are on the Earth's surface, and we are, if you are close to some faults, there is some likelihood that these faults may bifurcate, as nicely shown on this photo. Okay, now if we look into faults, what is important, we look into, for the design purpose, we must know what is the movement, fault movement, which has to be assumed. And this is just a schematic view. Basically, the movement is along this fault plane. We have a horizontal movement, and we have a movement in the direction of the dislocation. So we have two components, a horizontal component, which we can split up, the horizontal component and the vertical component. So therefore, if we have a dam on that, we have to design for horizontal and vertical displacement. And for some dams, for some faults, it is very difficult to say the movement is only horizontal. In the Himalayas, probably we had some discussion with seismotectonic people. Their idea was also the movement may be mainly in a vertical direction. We may still have a significant horizontal component. Okay, this shows here for the vertical offset. This is an issue of normal and reverse faults. If you have this part of the rock, will move downwards. Okay, this is called a normal fault. And if the plane is inclined in this direction and we have a movement up here, it is called a reverse fault. This is just some definition on faults, because we distinguish between normal faults, reverse faults, and horizontal faults. But it is not just faults which are creating problems. As I've mentioned, it is also cracks in dams. Cracks could be reactivated by a strong earthquake, as in this case, this is the foundation gallery of the Sefidrut Dam in Iran. So it's under high water pressure. There was already a small crack fissure here from a construction, because the dam is located on two geological formations, and it was watertight, but due to earthquake, there was some small displacement, small openings of this fissure, and you can see here water now is splashing in from the upstream face of the dam, from a reservoir. Of course, when you have large tectonic faults, so therefore the movement in this case is maybe only a tenth of a, is only a fraction of a millimeter, but it is enough then to create here this leakage. And once we have this leakage, is actually it is undesired, because it shows that the water pressure here is within the dam body. So So therefore, if we do stability analysis, in stability analysis, you have to account for the uplift pressure. So you would have here some critical wedges, for example. If you would have to analyze their safety, you would have to assume that full uplift pressure is acting, whereas in a dry fissure, okay, the stability is much less critical than in the case you have full uplift pressure. Okay, if you have a major fault like here in Taiwan, in also 1999, is severe. We had a movement of about 9 meters vertical. This is the main movement. But there was also horizontal movement, and it damaged these two openings of this sphere, which had already 20 openings. You see here also shearing off of this pier. There's another view of this sphere. It didn't cause any catastrophe. The reservoir was released because the reservoir volume was only about 2 million cubic meters. And during monsoon period, having that many years, people are releasing much more water than through the two destroyed deer openings. Today, if you go there, okay, prohibit to cross over, it has become a piece of a museum in Taiwan, so you can still visit this case. There is a cofferdam around it, so it is isolated from the main structure today. So if you want to see this case, famous case, you can still see it. Now, if a fault, you know, is from this fault movement, we have also crack propagating here, as you can see, through this reinforced concrete pier. Okay, this is this radial gate for this Chikang pier. Also, if you have fault movement, it affects other structures. This is the intake shaft. Also for this Chikang pier, and you can see here, due to this ground movement, we have quite some offset spalling off of concrete. Now, to say people actually, no engineer actually wants to build a dam on an active fault. And I would say nobody would admit basically that he is building a dam on an active fault. But the facts somehow are different. This is Inguri Arch Dam in Georgia, in the former Soviet Union, with 272 meters. For several years, it was the highest arch dam in the world. Maybe for those who are interested, this dam also has a so-called peripheral joint or pulvino, which is, and this here is a concrete saddle, which is done actually to reduce on the upstream phase the tensile stresses and to give the valley shape a more symmetric shape. And we know if you have a symmetric a structure, the seismic behavior, of course, is much better than if you have a highly anti-symmetric structure. Okay, so that is at some time. People, mainly in Italy, but also here in the Soviet Union, the people have built this pulvino or peripheral joint in arch dams. Today, we are not doing it, or I have not seen it recently. Now here, on this dam, we have on this elevation, I must say on the right bank, there is actually also a fault. And you can see that here. It is marked in the red. And when the dam was built here, this fault was declared inactive. But afterwards, I must say, people are not so sure. And this dam is now declared potentially active. And people are monitoring this dam. So there is, even in a one of the world's highest arch dam. Now there are some higher ones in China, about 3 or 4 or higher than this one, is actually on a potentially active fault, and such faults, if they exist, of course, due to the change of the pore pressure regime, groundwater level, it may change the resistance in this fault, and it may move due to impounding of the reservoir, which I think has not been the case up to now. But I just want to say, faults which have been declared as inactive in the past, I think, which is also true in the Himalayas for older dams, if you have a second look into these faults, if they are in the footprint of a dam, you may arrive at a different definition, and a fault which has been inactive may be declared today as potentially active, as in this case. We see here is the case of Iran, is a Barezu arch dam, about 20 meters high, and we see here there is a fault passing through the dam. People have at one time proposed to take some measure, but I would say, I will show you then also, arch dams are extremely vulnerable to foundation movement, so therefore to have here a fault which has been declared actually as active here, it passes through this left abutment of this Shirvan dam. What we see here, the whole view, same picture. It is quite a big dam which was completed not long time ago. Okay, you see here the fault passing here through this, area here, and then passing through the dam, and we have seen it from a downstream phase. This here is a tulip shape, I must say, spillway. I have also some doubts. Okay, it is not too bad. It is ungated, okay. But we have seen in some places in Malaysia in the 60s, 70s, people were keen in having this kind of intakes. But in areas where you have floating debris and so on, these are somehow problematic. But here it is almost, you see, you have hardly any vegetation or any trees. Another case is a Rogun Dam. Rogun Dam is the world's highest dam, actually, which was planned, and it is under construction. If you open a dictionary or a lexicon and you check for the highest dam in the world, it is given Rogun Dam. It mentioned that already for 30 years. But it was not built until recently. Now it is under construction. You see here, when Tajikistan became independent, we did the excavation of the core and so on, and the diversion, we don't, somewhere here, there was a strong rainfall, a large flood, which basically washed away the cofferdam, which was required to construct this dam. Okay, we see here, this dam actually is also crossed by several faults. There are faults perpendicular, if I say. The faults pass like that in a cross river direction. Usually we assume that the faults more go in direction of a river, but in this case the faults are more in the cross river direction, and it is planned as a Earth Core Rockfill Dam. It doesn't come here through the core, it goes here through the shell material. Now, what is the situation? Okay, to see this fault, the two major faults, this is the footprint of a dam. It will be 335 meters high. So the footprint is very large. It's more than a kilometer. So there is a fault here. Is in the in this part is, I would say, is uncritical because it is already far away from the core. And the second fault, major fault, also perpendicular to the river, more or less, is also not in the core area. So therefore, if you have some fault movement along these faults, okay, it is not really that critical, but I have mentioned before that we still have some secondary deformations near some of the existing faults, which depend, of course, on the mechanical properties and the geological structure of the foundation. Now, dam construction is like that. It is done in sequence. As you can see here, already one unit is in operation, but it still takes quite some time until the dam is finished. From a 335 meters, I think actually it is only about, it is less than half at this time. So it's still a lot of construction work. So therefore, if you look in some list of highest dam, this dam has not yet been finished. Now, other famous dam is Tarbela Dam. It is one of the Indus River. It is one of the largest rock fill dam in the world. And this dam consists of a main dam and some side dams and the spillway in operation. There are some faults in the foundation. Okay, here we see the main dam here, and there are some faults which have been active, and people have recorded activity in this dam reservoir region. So I want just to use these examples that some of the world's largest dams, actually they have already active or potentially active faults in their foundation. Now, we were involved in this high concrete face rock fill dam, almost 200 meters high in Iceland. It's called Karanjukar. It's a concrete face rock fill dam. As you can see here, this is the upstream face, concrete face. And there was also a tectonic fault at the deepest in the valley direction. Let's just show it. Okay, during the excavation, they found this fault. It was excavated, and so therefore, and it is anticipated that there may be some movements may be possible. So in the upstream phase, I'm showing you here, we have this toe wall. Sorry, point to toe, now it comes here. It is this region. It was filled. What I have shown here is just the excavation we have done. This was filled by a toe wall, and then it was covered by different types of filters and materials to block, for example, if there should be any leakage. Okay, so we have here this fault in a footprint of the dam, and you see here it is like that. This is this fault at the deepest point in the river, and it is expected if the reservoir is filled, actually, also due to the increased pressure here. Okay, this is just a model. I must say, some people expected or they considered also a possible opening of this or separation of this fault here, of this fault, giving this displacements in the range of a few millimeters or centimeters. So therefore, if you have a concrete phase, this will give some problems in the concrete, which is very rigid. So this is a cross section of this dam. This is a concrete phase. Here they found basically this fault, and there was, in order to save some, let me say, volume of the dam, there was a toe wall was provided here in this area, which was then sealed with the grout curtain and also with a lot of grouting. So to do some consolidation there and also to control the seepage in that zone. But still, okay, this is a view now. The photo I've shown here is covered. It is now covered by earth here. This is this toe wall. It was an RCC wall. And if we enlarge it, you could see basically this joint goes through this toe wall. So there is this fault. And in order to, because there could be some movement of water pressure, so in this toe wall, they introduced some galleries here to do some measurements, some recording, and there were two expansion joints were provided in this toe wall to cope, hopefully, with any opening and deformations of this joint. Of course, if you have here this kind of gallery, if you would have some leakage later on, you could do some additional grouting if it would be necessary. So you have basically here in this toe wall, you have some galleries. Also in embankment dams, these days you do not have any control galleries. Okay, this is for the case of this Karanyukar. Earthquake has not yet occurred, but okay, we are never sure, so people have to take some precaution. It is actually in Karanyukar, it was not only when the joint expansion joint here, it was also in let me say here in the concrete phase, you see you have here panel width of about typically about 15 or 16 meter, and in some zones, the critical zones, you make it more narrow. Here you have a flexible joint, so in the movements here could take place in this concrete phase. Sorry. So there are basically two dams which have been concrete dams which have been built on faults. Again, the faults were found during the excavation. The most famous one here is this Clyde Gravity Dam in New Zealand, which has a slip joint here. You know, it is the arrow is shown here. Okay, we have this slip joint is provided here. As I said, if we know we have some active fault, we usually would we would avoid this kind of joints. Okay, here is a photo now showing this construction. This is a joint. This is the upstream phase, and you can see some width here. The joint displacement were only a few decimeters. But if the dams would move, then this joint would leak. So there has been a kind of a triangular plug provided, which plugs basically this joint. Okay, you see inside the dam, because the faults are not just perpendicular, they are inclined. So the sliding surfaces are provided in direction of the fault plane, as you can see here. This is a view within this joint. again here this is this point here at the downstream phase, but the movement here is in this direction, so it it has to have some width in order to allow this kind of relative displacement. Inside the joint it looks like that, is a kind of a cavity opening. I don't want really to explain everything here about the kinematics. You may have a look into that. Maybe the interesting thing is the upstream phase. You provide this triangular concrete block. If these two sides move relative to each other, this block here is pressed by the water pressure into this triangular shape, and it will seal this joint after the movement. Therefore, you have this triangular block in Switzerland, I think for military purposes, and so the high blast, people are also using this kind of concepts. Okay, we see here within the joint, we have the orientation of the sliding surface, it must be in direction of the fault plane. But in addition, as we can see here, this is the dam. There was then for this potential fault, you see here at the base, you need extensive grouting, and some additional work was basically carried out for this dam project. There were additional control galleries, as you can see here, and it turned out, I would say, that the cost of this dam were doubled or even more than doubled than the original design, only for this fault. So the cost of this fault has basically doubled the cost of this project. So therefore, it is not really a good idea to provide slip joints. It makes it very difficult. The sealing in the foundation, everything becomes extremely difficult. And as you can see in the previous case, it caused this doubling of the cost. But the first dam, which was designed with a concrete dam, which was designed with a slip joint, was Morris Dam in 1934. There was also a fault found in this direction. So people did a fault. Okay, we see it is a little complicated, but we see here again, the fault plane, of course, is in this direction. So there was this vertical joint with different sliding surfaces here. So this block could move along this joint. There is the main fault here, but as I've shown previously, there is also likelihood sometimes, depending on the geology, to have a branch fault or secondary fault, which may also undergo some movement if major movements go here. So there has been some kinematic models which are provided in a way that this part here, the vertical one, which allow that this concrete dam could undergo some fault movements if that fault would ever move. Okay, generally we could say most likely we hope that this will never be the case. We, our company, we also designed an arch dam, is 175 meters high. It was in the 1970s, 80s, where people were thinking arch dams are the dams to be built. Everybody wanted to build arch dams. So there was a site in Greece, Steno arch dam, and you can see here there was a fault in the foundation, which goes in this direction. This is a plan, and this is a view. It's of course inclined and goes there. And here also kind of a peripheral joint was provided, and the system was provided here with movements, displacement, also the orientation of the concrete blocks, that some displacements could take place, and it was tested in a laboratory in Portugal. But I must say, it is, I don't think it is a good idea. And fortunately, I must say, this dam has never been built. But there have been projects where people actually were trying everything to, let me say, to build the dams, arch dams, which should not be built at such locations, to build them everywhere, because they were really fashionable, and the dam engineers, a good dam engineer, had to say, I'm building an arch dam to be the state-of-the-art project. Today, for concrete dams, we say it is no longer arch dam, it is RCC dam. For embankment dams, people say it is concrete face rock dams, but today people even say it is better to have asphalt core rock fill dams. So therefore, let me say, it is like in a fashion industry, also in dam design, people may have some preferences in the dam type. I think it is not, this is a questionable development, but there are quite a few people who think like that. Okay, this is a dam is in at the Nilom River, and you can see here there is basically this here is a main boundary thrust. Goes here. One of the main faults of the Himalaya, which is several hundred or thousand kilometers long, and it could create a strong earthquake. Basically, there was already Muzaffarabad earthquake in 2004 with a magnitude 7.6, which was not too far from this location. So you see, this is a concrete structure. Spilling, this is the desander, and here is the spillway, the concrete spillway structure. But what I want to say is, today, rather than using a slip joint, I think the best slip joint you can do is basically to provide here an embankment dam, which can be deformed. That should be the proper solution, because as we have seen here, in this case, you may have some, the fault plane may not just be 10 centimeters thick, it may involve some other parts, especially when you build some concrete part, it changes the strength properties here in this area. So therefore, you will more have to think that the fault movements may not actually occur at the location where people anticipated. So I would say slip joints in concrete dams, I would say, is a very poor design. None has been tested, and I would say it is quite questionable if these dams, which have been designed with a slip joint, will behave as planned. We do not really know. Most likely they will not behave like that. So it will remain the exemption. But here, there are on this side here on the right bank, we have this slip joint. And you see here, this is the spillway structure, this spilling, the desander. And you see here, this is basically the main boundary thrust. It is not just a point. It has a certain width, so therefore, a rock fill dam which can resist this movement. The movement is here mainly in a vertical direction. So, and the movement was about almost 4 meters, which this dam has been designed. Much more and the movements of a few decimeters for the concrete dam, which I have shown. Okay, so if you do slip joints, you better think of embankment dams. Now, why am I critical about the behavior of concrete dams due to foundation movement? And I would like to show two examples. This here is a Sussier arch dam in Switzerland, which has experienced some foundation movement, not due to faulting, but due to change in the groundwater table, because we were drilling an exploratory tunnel and they drained the groundwater, and therefore the rock deformed and it created some cracks. Okay, this is a picture I've taken not long time ago, but if you could look, there have been some inclined cracks here along this downstream face, along the abutments, which have been repaired. This damage occurred already 40 years ago, 1978. Okay, this is this layout. It's quite a high dam, 154 meters. So there are no faults, but there have been movements, as I said, due to lowering of a groundwater table, which in this asymmetric valley caused actually some settlement. You see here, settlement along the crest, which was 12 centimeters. It's a lot. Okay, if it would settle as a whole body, a rigid body, nothing would happen, but it was some differential movements from left to the right abutment. And you can see here, this is about N16 is this, the maximum is 12 centimeters. So if you have here 12 centimeters, on the other side, you have maybe 14 centimeters. You have only differential movements of 2 centimeters. In addition, we had some narrowing of the valley here, of the abutments, and we had some small rotation, of course, also rotation component of these two valley flanks. Now, what has happened due to 2 centimeters displacement? If we talk about faults in dams, we talk about decimeters or even more, meters in some cases. So you see here, along the whole dam, there have been cracks, and these cracks opened up with a maximum opening of about 15 millimeters. This is at the downstream phase, and in the upstream phase, it is basically the block joints which opened. But they are not cracks, they are the block joints. But here is the repaired, so the cracks here occurred all along this 154 meters high dam, arch dam. It's quite a thin arch dam. And once people did a lot of investigations, then of course they found some cracking within the dam body here, more crackings in dams. So it is not just these cracks are surface cracks. And I show this case, there was one crack here, which was found to be like this, but I have given them in red anticipation that this crack may develop in this way in the case of an earthquake. If you would have earthquake shaking, then the existing crack will grow, most likely. And if it would grow in this case, this upper portion of the dam may slide into the reservoir. So this upper portion would become unstable. So this cracked dam is not unproblematic, as you can see from this schematic sketch. Okay, this is, as I said, we talk here about displacements in the range of a few centimeters, 2-3 centimeters. In a fault, we have larger displacements. So therefore, this kind of dams, you know, if you have it in the Himalayas, you would still have some tectonic movement. I would say it is not a good idea to build arch dams. they would be very susceptible to traudation movement. This here is a Beauregard Dam in Italy. And it was completed also 60 years ago on the 32 meters high. It looks very nice here. It had also what we call this peripheral joint, because this idea of peripheral joint was coming from Italy. Now, this dam here, the problem of this dam is that on this side here, during the Ice Age, let me say 25,000 years ago in Alps, this valley were all covered by hundreds of meters of ice. And with the withdrawal of the ice, melting ice in the Holocene about 11,000 years ago, this stabilization of the slope through ice disappeared. So this, let me say, abutment started to creep, and there was some creep movement here going on for for the last 10,000 years almost. But people built in the 60s, everybody wanted to build dams, and the Italian people were very keen in building very extremely slender dams, as you can see here. So the story goes as follows. You know, 1963, there was, this is just 5 years after completion of this dam, you have the big catastrophe in Vaillant Dam in Italy. It's a 262 meters high thin arch dam, where a big landslide moved into the reservoir and displaced about 200 million, 250 million cubic meter of water, and overtopped the dam crest by about 100 meters. You know, water depth over the dam crest was about 100 meters. This is a Vaillant, and it killed then in a downstream valley about 2,000 people. So after that event, people noted that this slide here also was moving. The Vaillant case was the slip was the mass which was sliding there was about 300 million cubic meter. But this here is even bigger. It's even bigger than Vaillant. It's even more than this 250-300 million cubic meter. So therefore, people being afraid for until 63, the reservoir was filled twice, and after 1963, the reservoir was only kept 10% full. So for the last 50 years, 55 years, the reservoir was kept almost empty because of this hazard of this movement. Okay, now, but what I want to say is, what is the vulnerability of this dam to this movement? As I mentioned, we have this slope which undergoes some creep movement. Some movement has already taken place here, as I said, since the withdrawal of the ice, since the Ice Age. So we had some movement, and people, of course, tried to stabilize this movement by drainage systems and so on. Yeah, this is a tip. This is usually being done. But some movement still, they could reduce the movement quite a lot, but still some movement was going on. And you see here, this is now from the downstream phase, when this movement was taking place here, it created these cracks. It cracked. So this small movements in this arch dams, it created a lot of cracks. You cannot, okay, they are marked here, so you can see them. But when we visited there a couple of years ago, they were demolishing the upper portion of the dam, and you could see some of the cracks. This is at one block joint. This is a pen, it's about 10 centimeters. You see these cracks which were formed in this arch dam. They were not small. Also in this picture, they look very small, but if you look in a block joint, these cracks are very massive. They are 10 centimeters wide. Okay. So therefore, it was then decided to demolish the top, I think about the top 60 meters of the dam were demolished by blasting. And then the dam, the arch dam, was basically converted into an arch gravity dam, which is now is less than 100, is less than 100 meters high. I think I should visit it again to see the finished dam, because this is quite an important case. Again, the displacements, the foundation movements, were very small, but they create big safety concerns for arch dams. So if you have some unstable abutments, or if you have some faults in the foundation, in the footprint of an arch dam, or also concrete dams in general, these dams are quite vulnerable and they will crack in a very complex way, which people will not be able, or I would say, are not really able to predict. So therefore, it is better not to do analysis for 100 years until you find a solution. It is better to use a dam type which is not vulnerable to such movement. Now, ICOLD has published Built 112, Neotectonics and Dams, which is basically a guideline on dams on active faults. Okay, so that's the title for engineers. This is a title for seismotectonic people. Okay, now what does this ICOLD guideline say? I think it is quite important, and I must say, you do not have to read everything, but you must know the main the main statement, the main conclusion. And what is written here is: recognizing and accepting the existence of a capable fault in a dam foundation requires actually drastic steps, and that means the site should preferably be abandoned in favor of a tectonically more stable one. Because I said at the beginning, no dam engineer basically wants to build a dam on a fault, on an active fault. Let me say, if they are inactive, it is another question. Okay, there are many on the so-called inactive fault. Now, however, there are cases when it is not possible to find a tectonically more reliable site. In such cases, concrete dams should preferably be eliminated as an advisable choice, and an embankment dam with conservative features is to be considered. Okay, so if you are in an area where you have the tectonic movements, I think the best dam type is actually a conservatively designed rock fill dam, not concrete dams. Okay, this concrete dam people don't like to hear that. Okay, now, what are the dams which can resist such ground movements? And I would like to say a few words about embankment dams to resist fault movements. Okay, the main features of such dams, of rock fill dams, to resist fault movements and strong ground shaking, because this occurs at the same time. You have fault displacement and strong ground shaking basically occur at about the same time. Okay, there are a number of guidelines which you should follow. If you follow them, I think it is possible still to build an embankment dam over important faults, as I've shown with the main banker trust. Okay, impervious core should be made of, okay, what we say, self-healing material, whatever that means. Prevention of internal erosion should be provided if the core is cracked. And that, of course, is done by providing thick filter and transition zones. We say that about 50% of the fine sand filter should still be available after faulting. And if we have a strong shaking, we also have some slope movements. That means we should have a wide dam crest. I think embankment dam with 3 meters crest width is not a good example. It should rather be 15 meters. We should have rather flat slopes. Should have a generous freeboard to prevent overtopping due to impulse waves in a reservoir and due to settlement of a dam. And there should be careful material selection and high quality compaction of the rock relative. That means the execution of the work must be done very good. So these are very general guidelines here, which we can provide. Now for the analysis, this is an analysis done today. People like to do all kinds of analysis. This is an embankment dam where people used the analysis only of a fault movement here, mainly a vertical one in New Zealand with FRAC 3D. I would say it is not necessary to do actually such a complicated analysis. It is, if you have a fault offset, let me say of 3 meters, you could still assume this to be a rigid body, and therefore this fault will deform, will propagate here at this interface. Okay, this zone is a little distributed and the deformations are damped at the crest if you do the three-dimensional analysis. This is okay if you want to do an analysis, but for the design, in our opinion, it is enough if you assume that these blocks here behave as rigid bodies. Okay, what are the seismic design parameters for dams with active fault in the foundation? Of course, from the seismotectonic people, you must know, you must get the geometry of a fault and you must get the fault movements. That means the maximum displacements along the fault plane. So they should keep that for the worst case of earthquake. Unfortunately, I must say, yeah, most people, geologists and seismotectonic people, have some difficulties in specifying such kind of movements. The number two factor is important is, of course, what the width of a fault, if it is only a few centimeters or if it is actually a few meters. And we must know, because if you have this faulting during a strong earthquake, we have a strong ground shaking. So at the same time, we must have the maximum acceleration. We must have the acceleration time histories, which takes into account near fault effects and also the directivity effects can be taken into account if you know that in advance. But if you have faults which are not well defined, which are not going through the footprint of the dam, basically at this time, ICOL does not require that you take account of near fault and directivity effects. Also, seismologists, seismotectonic peoples, okay, of course, they emphasize the importance of these factors. Okay. Now, I have prepared one a separate presentation of an example of a dam site with multiple discontinuities. Now, the ones I have shown you had just about one or two in the case of Rogun in Tajikistan, but we did one case in Iran, which I would call is somehow the most difficult site from the tectonical viewpoint up to now. So therefore, I would say if you have some dams on faults, you can learn quite a lot from that case study, which will be presented during a separate presentation tomorrow. But I just want to give this example just to show the dam is here. It is a very narrow valley, and according to the ICOLD guidelines, again, a rock fill dam, a conservatively designed rock fill dam, has been provided. The dam, the ratio of dam height to crest length is about one. So you would say, well, you would have to build a concrete dam, you have to build an arch dam or gravity dam, RCC gravity dam, and people have come up with that. But the problem is you have here at this location, we have a number. Okay, here we have already some faults. There are faults here. There are faults everywhere here. It's full of faults. So therefore, based on that, and nobody, I would say, can define a reliable model of fault movements within a reasonable time of a reasonable period. I would still say seismologists and other people would still work on the seismotectonic model today, but the dam has already been finished 3 years ago. It would, so therefore, you cannot just wait until people come up with some scientists, come up with some studies, which I don't think this study would have brought any benefit, but you would rather follow a safe procedure to select, in this case, as I said, an embankment dam, an earth core rock fill dam, rather than a concrete dam, which would have to require multiple slip joints or would require the definition of potentially active faults as inactive faults and so on. So I would say in a case of doubts in general, it is much better to go for the safe solution. And this is a safe solution. As I said, I will discuss it tomorrow. I must say here, fault movements which have been considered in different directions were about 1.5 meters. At the footprint, there are many more with movements of about 50 or so centimeters. So I would say people can learn here quite a bit from this model. Now, let me say a few words about limits of movements in dam foundations, in earth core rock fill dams. We require that after fault slip, the remaining filter zone should be at least 2 meters or 50 centimeters or 50% of the filter zone. And I would say for design purposes, it would be safe to use a safety factor of 1.5 for the fault movement, because these estimates are also, what shall I say, have a lot of uncertainty. So for design purposes, you would rather use some safety factors. Now, if we have a fault offset of about 1 meter, and we require that the still 2 meters of a fine sand filter is still available after this offset, and we take a safety factor of the offset of 1.5, this would give a thickness of a filter of about 3.5 meters. Okay. So this shows you how, if you have a fault, how you can cope with fault displacement. So the other fault I have shown you there in the main boundary thrust, which have almost 4 meters vertical displacement. You also have to look at this. Here is a horizontal displacement, this example I'm showing here. So for the vertical displacement, we need also a thick filter zone because of the inclination of the core. You do not have to add that much, but you would have to look into kinematics, but it still gives, let me say, filter zones of the order of 5 meters or so. But to be sure that you do not have a problem of internal erosion. In addition, the clay material of the core should be more plastic over the fault zone, so that when it is sheared during the displacement, it will not form open cracks, which could initiate internal erosion. But as I said already, internal erosion is basically protected by the fine sand filters. But if you have problematic foundation condition, of course, you also have, and if you know them, then you have to take care of them. Now, the maximum fault displacement, horizontal at all, also vertical, which can be easily tolerated without any problems in conservatively designed rock fill dam, I would say is 1 meter or more. If you have larger displacements, of course, you have some implications. You need a wider filter zone. Typically today, we say anyway, for, let me say, filter zones, it should be the width of one truck, so you can place it economically. The minimum width of different filter material is already 3 meters today. Also, in the past, there have been some dams we have seen in the Philippines and also in Thailand, I think, which had only a filter thickness of 1 meter. 1.5 meter maximum. This is by far, this is a quite risky, I must say. Today you do not do that. Unless maybe some people really want to save money and to save material. You do not know today, maybe somebody comes back to a small dimension for reducing the CO2 footprint or to increase the sustainability index and so on, all kinds of non-technical issues to save on that side could have a negative impact on some safe design. So you should not consider such factors in the dam safety. Okay, now if you look at concrete face rock fill dams, concrete face rock fill dams, I have shown. You have a concrete face, you have a vertical panel with a width of about 15 meters typically. And at the base, you must provide a grout curtain, and that is provided by a plinth. So at the, along the dam, let me say dam abutment, dam foundation contact, you have this plinth, and the plinth is a concrete structure. You can have a plinth in Thailand. There was one that had some critical, they were also crossing a fault there. So they provided a plinth gallery. Plinth gallery, of course, has the advantage if you have some fault movements later, or you have some leakage, you can do some grouting from a plinth gallery. This is, of course, some big advantage. Otherwise, you have to use divers if you cannot lower the reservoir, which is divers, I must say, is extremely expensive. Especially if the water depth is in the order of 100 meters or more, when I must say it is really very expensive. Okay, so there is then a place, there is of course then some problem with the deformability of the plinth. The plinth will be reinforced concrete, but I would say the maximum fault displacements in concrete face rock fill dam should only be small. I've given here some value of 10 to 20 centimeters. We can have plinths. Yeah, in a plinth, we do not really want to have joints because we need this water stops and so on. And I would say we can provide today concrete face rock fill dams which have wider, let me say, vertical joints. In the past, older concrete face rock fill dams, the concrete face, the concrete plates were concreted almost with only a little spacing of a few millimeters, which were then plugged by plywood or something like that. And these do not allow large deformations. Today, I would say you would select some joint spacing of a few centimeters, let me say 2 or 3 centimeters at some location within the concrete face, which would allow some deformations taking place along these joints without crushing or destroying actually your concrete face. So we should think only of a few centimeter fault plate displacement for concrete face rock fill dams of older date. Newer one, I would say 10 to 20 centimeters, but I would say it's better not to use that. Okay. Now, if we look at concrete or normal concrete or RCC gravity dam, most people like to build now this RCC gravity dam, or even the Chinese come up with, let me say, rock fill dam with self-compacting concrete. In my opinion, it's nothing different from masonry dams, but they promote that, so this would fall under the same category. Now, I would say for concrete, which is a rigid material, that means rigid means a small tensile strength, it will crack if you have substantial tensile stresses, which will be caused by foundation movements. So therefore, for gravity dam, we would say, of course, gravity dams, it is not a monolithic structure. It is built of blocks with a width of, let me say, 50 meters. If conventional mass concrete is used, but if you look now for RCC gravity dam, people use induced cracks and so on. Some of the crack distances are in some dams 40, 50 meters. It's not so, I don't think it makes them more monolithic, but it makes them more, let me say, vulnerable to foundation movement. So there will be more cracking because the fault deformations cannot be taken up by fault movements. Okay, so therefore I've given here some value of about 10 centimeters. So we talk only about small numbers. Now, what would be concrete arch and arch gravity dams? Basically, the same items apply here like those for gravity dam. But the difference is that arch and arch gravity dams are monolithic dams. The idea is to build a kind of a shell structure, which is a monolithic structure. We do not have open joints like in gravity dams, which are provided with water stops where movements can take place or refilled by some polyurethane foam or some soft material. But in the case of arch dams, we need for the to that we have a three-dimensional or that the arch action becomes important, we need a monolithic structure. So therefore, the crack pattern, as I've shown in the two previous cases, which were not subjected to fault movement, already small abutment movements will create a complex crack pattern in arch dams and also arch gravity dams. And secondly, we have to take into account that the dam is already cracked due to fault movement. So basically for the safety check, we have to look into the dynamic behavior of a cracked dam. Okay, but the crack pattern may be very complicated. So it would be very difficult basically to show that the cracked dam, which I've shown before, would be seismically safe. I would say it is beyond the present analysis capabilities to make such predictions. So therefore, I must say, rather than spending years, it will be like that, years or hundreds of thousands or even millions of dollars for the analysis. It is better actually to go for safer dams. But for existing dams, I must say, the value which we accept here somehow is about 5 centimeters. I would like to say, in Switzerland, we built the Gotthard Railway Tunnel. It's a 57-kilometer long double-tube railway tunnel, the longest in the world. And it crossed the Alps, and it crossed below three dams, large arch dams. So therefore, due to this construction of this railway tunnel, you have some change in the water table. You have some deformations on the ground surface. Also, the rock cover of the tunnel reached up to 2,000 meters, but at the dam it was maybe 1,000 meters. But if you build large diameter tunnels, you may have some deformation on the surface, or you may have a change in the groundwater regime, which may create further displacement. So therefore, in that, during that construction, basically the acceptable deformations of these arch dams, three of them, were given with about 5 to 8 centimeters, depending on the, let me say, for full reservoir, because you have then high arch stresses, compressive stresses, they allowed about 8 centimeters, but for low reservoir, that would be in spring, they allowed only about 5 centimeters. So when we talk about acceptable or limits of fault movements, they will be extremely small. So if you have some fault movements, like on a main boundary thrust, okay, some segments, some people may say it may be inactive or it may not have moved for thousands of years, but it would be safe, certainly, to use a dam pipe which is not vulnerable to plantation movements, and that are embankment dams. And finally, I would also mention with the limits, we also have today, it is fashionable, we have asphalt core rock fill dams, and the asphalt core is thin, like a concrete face, basically 1 meter on the top. It is even thinner. It is a few tens of centimeters. So therefore, if you have a fold offset, it may also damage this concrete face if the fold is passing through this asphalt core. So therefore, I would say basically the same criteria apply to the asphalt core concrete dam as for the concrete face rock fill dams, but we accept only a few centimeters. Okay, I would just give some examples. When I'm talking here about a dam subjected to strong ground shaking, because in India, I must say, my observation was in the past that people used, if I compare it with, for example, with California, Western United States, they used relatively small, seismic hazard values. But I just want to show that today there are dams which are built for higher values than you used to do, and also what we assumed in the past in Switzerland. Now the values have become higher. This is this Nilum Jhelum project in Kashmir, which is on the main boundary thrust. Actually, peak ground acceleration is 1.26 G. This is high, for example. And there are this fault movement, mainly vertical. It is the thrust is the main boundary fault, main boundary thrust, which is normal fault, which gives mainly a vertical component of 3.7 meters. So it has been designed for these high values. And I think it is designed, in my opinion, it is absolutely okay. Now, the second case is Ruth Barloristam, which I will present also tomorrow. Peak ground acceleration is about 0.75 G. And there are here my main boundary thrust is relatively simple because it's only a fault, but this fault has also a fault width of 10, 20, 30 meters. But in a Ruud Barloristam dam, we have multiple discontinuities in a footprint with seismic movements of up to 1.5 meters. It is not just one, there are many. There are several. There are more than 10. So it is quite difficult. There is another one in Angad, but here we cope with that with rock hill dams. We have the Angad rock hill dam, about 60 years old, in the Philippine water supply of Manila. We did a new analysis. We get also peak ground acceleration, about 1 G, and fault movements just at the left abutment of 4 to 6 meters. And here it is not clear if it is horizontal and vertical. In this zone, it has to be assumed to be horizontal and vertical. It is an existing dam, and it is also not clear if the dam passes 30 meters from the left abutment or if a branch actually is passing through the dam body. It is a secondary dam there. We had some others in Papua New Guinea. Papua New Guinea, I would say, is the country of the highest seismicity in the world. So we have here also 0.9, about 1 G. And here has a waterproofing element, a geotextile membrane at the upstream face was proposed. This dam finally is also in a landslide area there. It was not built, but I heard now that somebody comes up with the asphalt core rock hill dam. In my opinion, it is not a good solution. But geotextile, of course, also has, problems. The problem is that maybe some villagers may cut out they find that this material is useful for their housing and so on, and they may cut out some parts and damage the geotextile membrane. So there are with all kinds of, design features, there are some, or modern design features, geotextile, I would say, there are some problems. Now, we did a lot, actually, I've worked a lot in Iran for almost 30 years in many projects, and I must say, on all dams, there was no dam with a peak ground acceleration of less than 0.4, I must say. Typically, 0.6 or even larger. Also, in the Philippines, I would say Philippines is a country with which is subjected to the worst natural disasters. It is not only earthquake, it is a typhoon, it's a volcano, it's extreme rainfall. Okay, they have everything there. It is extreme. So we did some studies on existing dams, on Buklao, Binga, Maga, Aklan, and so on. And the accelerations are also 0.7, even to 1G. They are high. And at this time, we are doing a pump storage plant in Chile, more in the northern part of Chile. We are already at 1.8G, is a result of the seismic hazard study. But it is not yet clear if the dams, because pump storage, the dams are not very big dams, are not always big dams, so maybe the dam classification may not require the design against the worst case earthquake. But for the worst case earthquake, we have now already values of 1.8 G, and I understand that in the US, people have designed in, in Oregon or in Washington State, there is this subduction zone. People have designed an RCC dam, I think, with 2.5 G. So the values, some values are really high. There in India and those doing buildings, we are only concerned with acceleration of less than 0.2 G. We are, but some dams are in areas where you have very high acceleration, and you may know, okay, in Terry Dam has a long history of design and until completion, and I think the first studies were done in the 70s or maybe even earlier, and at that time people used pseudostatic analysis. And they started with 0.1, I think, like everywhere. But when the seismic hazard was upgraded until the strongest earthquake which was recorded at that time. Now to come to the conclusions, the most drastic feature for dams on faults is the surface fault break through the dam foundations. It is more dangerous, I would say, for concrete dam than ground shaking. But all seismic design is focused on ground shaking. But if you have fault breaking in the dam foundation, you may have a more critical state. And this is in particular true for arch dams. There are no doubts about that, and also for other types of concrete dams. If an active or potentially active fault in a dam foundation is recognized, actually far-reaching consequences for the design must follow. I would say one consequence, of course, is to change the dam type to an embankment dam if somebody has proposed a concrete dam, or as we have seen in the case of Clyde Dam, they have to do all kinds of, designs in order to show that this dam can withstand this ground movement. And it's double the cost. Okay, so that means far-reaching consequences. Also, the cost has doubled. It is not sure if this joint in concrete dam will actually work. Okay. Number three, when recent tectonic activity of a fault crossing the dam site is recognized and it is not possible to find an alternative site, a conservatively designed embankment dam with large transition zones on cohesive materials offers best chances to survive the fault break effect. So I would say in tectonically stressed region where people have underestimated the possibility of abutment movements, I would say there should be an increased trend in building rockfill dams, to say that. Also, rockfill dams are considered as old-fashioned, but I must say basically the important issue is that you have safe dams, and it is not a matter of fashion. The next point, in general, concrete dams should not be accepted for sites affected by active tectonic features. We have said that already for more than 20 years, but now I've again seen in Chile, somebody come up with a concrete dam with some slip joints. And of course, the argument is we do not find suitable material for the embankment dams. Okay, that is one of the excuses. Therefore, we have to go for the concrete dam and for the slip joint. Okay, usually one would have to follow, but this is also an argument, let me say, the same argument is used for people promoting asphalt core rockfill dams. They say, okay, asphalt core as a waterproofing element, it doesn't need much volume, and one could take, let me say, relatively poor rocks for the shell material. Because usually with embankment dams, the problem is with the material to be impervious core. But I mentioned the case in the examples, if we really have problems with the material, one could still think about an upstream geotextile, because this geotextile could undergo, is very flexible and could undergo relatively large movement without being damaged. The ultimate strain in elastic strains in such material is very large. Number two, if significant movement along a fault crossing the dam site is accepted, the best advice still is to select an alternative site. The problem is that the alternative sites do not exist in most cases. Okay, it is not just to move 50 meters or so. Maybe one would have to move a different location where you have the other hazards. So it is not so straightforward. So therefore, one should go, if it is not possible, one must go for a safe design. Now, with regard to slip joints, no dam foreseen to successfully survive the shearing action of a fault slip in its foundation has ever been exposed to actual tests. That applies especially to this concrete dam, Clyde Dam in New Zealand, Morris Dam in the US, and still people like to come up with this slip joint. In the case of, let me say, main boundary thrust, which I've shown, original design was also with the slip joint. You know, it is questionable. Okay, it hasn't really been done by constructing the slip joint as an embankment dam. So the embankment dam itself is a slip joint. Number four, dams and reservoirs crossed by active or potentially active faults are also candidates for reservoir triggered seismicity. I must say, by filling of a reservoir, but as reservoir triggered seismicity events are generally small, the surface rupture and fault movements are small or are zero. Because if you have magnitude 3 or 4 earthquakes, they will hardly cause surface rupture. Surface rupture is caused by large earthquakes. So it is exactly, I must congratulate myself that the time is exactly as planned. Nevertheless, I would say we have some time of discussion. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Thank you so much, sir, for your detailed and excellent presentation. Now, I request to the participants, if they have any questions, they may ask.
Can we just switch on the camera, please?
Sorry?
Can you allow us to switch on the camera, please?
Yeah, my camera is on.
Yeah, your camera is on. Is it okay? My voice is enough. There's no need to look at the picture. Yeah, Professor Dr. Martin, I am Professor S.D. Bharti from Jaipur. My question is that, has anybody done any study on the frequency content and the signal analysis of reservoir triggered ground motion vis-a-vis natural ground motions? I mean, has anybody done any study? I mean, do they have the near fault effect or something like that, some pulse kind of ground motion? I mean, magnitude is a very, you know, rounded number. And has anybody done detailed signal study of that?
Okay, I can. I'm not aware of this record. I'm only aware of the records from Koyna Dam, where people have recorded. I think in China they have not recorded. Also, the other dams which have experienced strong RTS events, I think they didn't have seismic monitoring, or the seismic monitoring was out of operation. So therefore, I think I'm not aware of that, but I'm also not the expert on that. You know, we have done, let me say, my committee, has compiled data from monitoring data from dams, and there are over 1,000 records. But these records are maybe 90% are from Japan, because there about 500 dams are equipped with strong motion instruments on the top and on at the base. So there you can do some statistical analysis, but it has shown that even in this case, where we have some, let me say, limited information, it is difficult to extract a lot of information, and maybe somebody can do that in some research institution. But we have seen it will be difficult to find good records. There are maybe plenty of records with micro events which are of no interest to the dam engineer.
Another thing is that, I mean, do you have any inkling whether this reservoir triggered ground motions exhibit some kind of pulse activity, which is a near fault, I mean, which is unique to near fault ground motion? I mean.
Yeah, but okay, we have this discussion on this impulse, velocity impulse, in a case of a project in Iran. Basically, in ICOLD, we said at this time, because the information is simply not available in almost all projects, you use attenuation laws which have been published, MGA 2 West, they are called in the US, and which includes recordings of all types of earthquakes, near field, far field, or near field, normal distance, and different sites, different orientations. And in these models, implicitly, these near field and directivity effects we say is already included. So, and we therefore propose that if you do the seismic analysis, you have to consider at least three earthquakes. Mm-hmm. So, but in Iran, okay, I said it is, I have no doubt, I have no objection against this analysis of near field directivity effect. And there was some seismotectonic person who has also done a PhD on that. And he has given this extra impulse. I said it's, it is okay, but it should not be lower than one if you use the traditional attenuation laws. It should be larger, not smaller.
Okay.
So that was my comment on that at that time. But
As it is, you have qualified that you should, you know, refrain from building dams near the faults. So that way, the ground motion recommendation that you ICOLD gives is that the three ground motions for responsivity analysis should be all conventional far field, or you should take at least one near field also.
Yeah, but we actually, large dams are being built close to faults. So we cannot prevent that. I would say this just produces ground motion. I would say we are afraid of fault displacements in the footprint of the dam. Okay, this is our main concern. But for the ground shaking, we are not that much concerned. And we do basically, I must say, at this time, the approach is relatively conservative when we say the so-called safety evaluation earthquake is maybe a 10,000 years return event, probabilistically, over worst case earthquake scenario, and using different, let me say, confidence levels of the ground motion parameters for probabilistic and deterministic analysis. But I would say if new information is available, this is a present state, and we do the analysis for a present state. But if in 20 years or so, new information, or even earlier, new information, important information has become available, one may have to recheck, taking into account factors which you have mentioned. If it really turns out that they are important factors, they may not be important also.
That's right. Okay, one last question, and not related to today's reservoir triggered seismicity, but that is regarding the methods of analysis. Between two methods, what we call pseudodynamic oblique response spectrum versus response history. I mean, what ICOLD recommends for all safety evaluation, go for straight for response history analysis, of course, nonlinear response history analysis, or pseudodynamic or response spectrum is good enough. I mean, what is the ICOLD recommendation on that?
Yeah, basically here we do not have a recommendation, but in Switzerland, I think I mentioned already, the response spectrum method, okay, it is only used for linear elastic structure.
Okay, got it.
So if you have nonlinear, we cannot go for that. We have to go for time history analysis. But for linear elastic structures, I would say today there is a lot of software doing this time history analysis, and I would say the computational effort, which in the past was very important, doesn't play here. So therefore, if you do a response spectrum method, it is not it's not really an advantage. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you have envy, you have to have this combination rules of peak values.
Yes, yes, yes. That's another assumption that we are making.
And different types of combinations, if you have eigenfrequencies which are closely spaced, and so on, all kind of methods. But this, if you do a time history analysis, you do not have these problems at all.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So one last expert comment I would expect from you is that, I mean, see, nowadays with the, you know, large computational facility and familiarity with the response history analysis, oblique time history analysis, what is preventing the industry practitioner from adopting response history analysis and, you know, just sticking to the pseudo static or response spectrum, you know, linear analysis? I mean, what is preventing them from accepting the, you know, nonlinear response history analysis?
Yeah, okay, the nonlinear is a little more difficult, but let me say just the normal one, if you do a normal, let's say, a first step in a dynamic analysis would actually always be for concrete times now, would be first to do a linear elastic analysis, just as a kind of a benchmark.
Yes.
So, because if two different people are doing linear elastic dynamic analysis, you could get the same results if you make the same assumptions. But yes, if the non-linear one, it is not so clear. Okay, so you would first do it anyway, the linear elastic dynamic analysis, and before you do that, you do the static analysis. The static analysis, dead low, water load, and so on, temperature, you would do it with a finite element analysis, and you have already a finite element model, and you would use the same finite element model then for the time history analysis, which should not be a big difference, because you have a model already, and then you have to combine the static loads with the dynamic stresses. So if you combine like that, it should be straightforward. Today, I don't see any reason why one should not do this linear dynamic time history analysis, which is already far better than the pseudostatic analysis. Because in the pseudostatic analysis, you could incorporate the analysis directly as a static load change. The dynamic analysis, you have also a question, I mentioned it already, I think, with the damping ratio. Okay, what kind of damping ratio? It is a discussion which is not yet resolved. There are some people wanted to use high damping ratio in order to reduce the dynamic response. You know, there are no really clear guidelines. There are some organizations proposing some values which are far from the observed values, especially for very high concrete depth.
That's right. Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So I am Vivek Tripathi from Central Water Commission. My question is regarding maximum fault displacement in CFRD. You have mentioned that maximum fault displacement in CFRD can be absorbed as 0.5 meter. And horizontal displacement 10 to 20 centimeter. So this horizontal displacement is across the flow or towards upstream can be absorbed, because it all depends on the parametric joints. If plinth moves 20 centimeter, can it be absorbed this type of movement?
Yeah. Okay, this is just to give some idea, but the concrete plinth, of course, is also vulnerable. So it's not so I must say this is more, I've discussed it with some people. And these people, they basically, they have made this estimate. So it is not based on analysis. The value I have given there for concrete phase rock fill dams is not really based on analysis. But we could say some of the big concrete phase rock fill dams have experienced already quite severe damage. Let me say, if we have in a plinth, if we have an offset of 20 centimeters, it does not mean that this concrete face rock fill dam will fail. Okay, it will basically leak. And the question would be then, is it possible to repair this leakage? So it will not cause a failure of the dam, I would say. But you will have quite some leakage, so you would have to have some repair to minimize this leakage. And if your deformations are not too big, so your amount of leakage is also much smaller. So I would say maybe some people may think differently. I have just discussed it with some embankment people, and we thought that could be a reasonable value. But we know already that these concrete dams, they would be damaged, or this concrete face would be damaged. But with the embankment dam, if a fault movement of 1 meter takes place, maybe you have to do no repair. It is just, it just remains safe. But with the concrete dams, you will have a lot of leakage, and you may have some other problems if you would have to repair it. But it will not fail. I also think it will not fail.
Okay. One thing more. What is the difference between the older design plinth and the new design? You have mentioned that 5 to 20 centimeter in the older design.
So it's not related basically to the plinth. It was more related to the concrete, to the face slab, because the face slab is built in let me say in elements, in slabs, vertical slabs with a width of, let me say, 18 meters or so, 15 meters or so, and you have a joint between edges and slabs. And I would say in the old days, this joint between edges and slabs have been a few millimeters. And they were basically, edges and slabs were almost in contact. So if these slabs are in contact and you have some displacement of a rock fill or settlement of a rock fill, and due to the different deformational behavior of a rock fill and the concrete will attract high stresses and it will then damage the concrete face. If the joints are basically in contact, but if you have a joint width of, let me say, 2 centimeters or 3 centimeters, adjacent will not come in contact and there will be no force will be transferred to adjacent elements, and there is no build-up then of in-plane stresses if you provide a certain gap width. So if you have a proper gap width, you can basically accept greater deformations of a dam also, and also of a foundation, whereas when in a foundation, the problem is when the plinth, I agree. But you would, in a plinth, we would then say it is reinforced concrete. So if it is reinforced concrete, also if you have some deformations, you will have a plastic deformation and you will not have concentrated cracks. You will have distributed cracks. So it makes it better. If the really unreinforced mass concrete dams, they would exhibit large cracks with large crack openings, But if you have a ductile plinth, if I may say like that, you could accept some deformations.
Thank you.
Thank you to the participant and Dr. Veelan Martin for such an interactive question answer session. Do we have another question as well? Mr. Ashwani Kumar.
Hello. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
You are.
Sir, yes. I wanted to ask, sir, whether is it possible for us or say a geologist to predict the amount of displacement due to RTS on any known fault?
Yeah. Okay, you would have to ask here a seismotectonic person. Usually we say in seismic hazard analysis to define the worst case earthquake scenarios. This is simpler, let me say, because we take the fault length and we say the fault length is, for example, equal the rupture length. Mm. And there are some empirical relations given by some people have been published, which relate the rupture length to the maximum magnitude. And then based on the magnitude, you can use our correlations to predict displacements along different types of faults. So I would say that would be the simple approach. But others, I must say, it will be very difficult. But as I said, most or from examples which I have shown or from a list of dams which have experienced RTS, most of the earthquakes were less than magnitude 5. And if you have magnitude 5 or less, I would say surface rupture is unlikely. So therefore, we have to say for these small magnitude events, we have hardly any surface rupture. Also, I have shown you the example of a dam in Lesotho in South Africa, where you had a crack in the foundation, a relatively long crack. But this crack was not really a fault. It was more had also to do with some thermal stresses, which were still present there from volcanic activity in that region millions of years ago. So I would say I'm not aware, but I would say the faulting compared to that one used for the design of the dam is very small. But the faulting would only be a problem, I would have to point out, if this fault would pass through a footprint of a dam. If this fault is outside of a dam, it is unimportant.
Yes, sir. I wanted to ask if it's lying within the dam footprint, yes.
So only those, but these are already, okay, these are already known. So if these footprints are given, there are already some design criteria or specifications of some movements for the worst case earthquake. And these movements would be one or two magnitudes larger than those which could occur due to RTS. So they would not be a problem also.
All right, sir. And sir, another quick question. Sir, how is the ground motion for RTS different from what we obtained from, let's say, for a DB condition, OB condition? Because I think this seismic source zone, I mean, this fault, this active fault, which is lying beneath the dam, was also considered during the evaluation of DB. Or let's say OB. So I think this it was considered earlier. So how is it possible that the RTS ground motion might be larger than the OBE condition?
Yeah, okay. There could be some cases because the OBE, now if we follow the ICOLD recommendation today, we say 145 years.
Yes.
And you get, for example, a peak ground acceleration of, let me say, 0.1 g. Because the OBE accelerations are not so big. But let's say 0.1 g. But if you do RTS, and RTS, some people make some, let me say, I assume usually we define a discrete model. Okay, we define that RTS could occur at this location at some fault, for example. Mm. And then somebody makes the estimate of the magnitude along that fault. Mm. And if you calculate then using the attenuation laws, which have been published, let me say, you can calculate due to that earthquake, you say, for example, RTS is a magnitude 5 earthquake at distance of 5 kilometers. Mm. And you calculate what is the ground motion at the dam site due to this magnitude 5 earthquake. And you get maybe 0.15 g acceleration at the site. So therefore, we would then assume that for the OBE, which is assumed to occur, we exceeded 50% with a 50% probability in 100 years. You replace that by the RTS, this 0.15, because this RTS occurs within 10 years, usually, okay. Not 100 years. And you expect it also occurs with a certain probability. It occurs within a shorter period of time than the OBE of 145 years. So therefore, for the damage of a dam, it is more likely then that the dam or buildings are damaged due to RTS within a short period of time than by the OBE.
All right, sir.
And the OBE, we say, is an economical criteria where the dam owner doesn't have to invest in repairs if the earthquake is smaller than the OBE. But if the RTS is larger than OBE, so he would have, on paper, he would have to invest already some money because within 10 years he had a ground motion which is likely larger than most due to OBE. Now this is a little weak argumentation.
Fine, so that means, so do we have any kind of number for the annual rate of exceedance, like 50% probability of exceeding in 100 years of service life, like that is for OBE. For RTS, can we define something like that?
Yeah, I think not. But, well, maybe there are some researchers doing that, but in practice, we have seen, my impression is, it is really very difficult. We have done it, just one example, we have done it for one dam in Zambezi Valley, it's a rift, eastern rift valley in southern part of Africa, and there they had already this magnitude 6.3 earthquake in Kariba. So since we proposed a dam also in this valley, but also it is 100 kilometers away or 200 kilometers, but it has the same, let me say, seismotectonic structure. So the seismic hazard person, he and seismotectonic people, they identified a fault at some distance from a new project. Their reservoir triggered seismic event could occur. And as upper bound, they used this 6.3 because this has occurred already all 50 years ago. Mm. So it was done by kind of some analogy, and people thought, okay, this will be on the safe side. Because you cannot predict it. That is a problem.
True, sir. Yes.
So at that time, we were then saying we are on the safe side. I must say, somebody who opposed that project, he said we are on the unsafe side, and somebody else who worked on that project as an engineer, he said we are too much conservative. You know, there are different opinions on these on these assumptions. But I would say this frequency analysis, it is very difficult. So therefore, because it is very difficult and you cannot do much, therefore I have explained in one of the slides what you can do. You know, you do a microseismic monitoring to protect the owner, because it is not, let me say, risky to the dam yourself. It is a problem to the people living in the dam and reservoir area. So you do microseismic monitoring so you can determine, hopefully, that an event is RTS or not. And if a seismicity occurs, people will come up with many claims. You have seen that in Switzerland, suddenly due to geothermal drilling and hydrofracturing, people came up with 1,000 claims from a magnitude 3 earthquake. They came up, they have seen small crack in cladding here and there, and some small damage, old cracks already, many buildings have some cracks. And when they were flooded with so many claims, so if you, as a dam owner, want to protect you from these, claims from potentially people, you do this microseismic monitoring and you do the inventory of the buildings in this dam reservoir area. Usually these dams are in remote places, hopefully. So you do not have to, this inventory does not include 1 million people, but it includes a few hundred people. So it is manageable. And the last, if you really do not want to do it, you ask for an insurance. You buy an insurance. Or if you identify some buildings which are really weak, you may even think, rather than strengthening, you may even buy them. Just for some special, for some special vulnerable structure, if you have identified them. So rather than doing the studies on this RTS, you better look how you can minimize these consequences and how you can protect, let me say, the dam owner, but how you can also protect protect fairly those who are affected. And you have to protect the dam owner from false claims. There will be, in Switzerland, I think 90% were false claims, or even more. So usually, and it costs a lot, this false claim, it add up also to tens of millions, unfortunately. So if you can take them out, it is important. Mm. And if you do studies on the frequency, this problem is also still there. It doesn't solve your problem. It is interesting to do it from the scientific point of view. Do this, to do statistics of reservoir triggered seismicity. But I think if you do statistics, the statistics is mainly for small events, magnitude 1, 2, or 0. There you can do statistics. You have quite a few events, but you do not have the events which are critical for the dam safety and for the people, which are the biggest one. There you do not have a statistic.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. If the participants still have more questions, they may write to us. We will arrange the answer, get back to you over the email. Thank you for the day. See you all tomorrow at 1100 hours IST. Thank you. Goodbye. See you tomorrow.
Okay, bye. Okay, yeah. Good evening. Okay. We have just lunch time now. Okay. See you tomorrow.